Thank you, Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues. I'm pleased to be once more with you to discuss how to optimize the use of innovative anti-HER2 drugs for our patients. Certainly, the availability of trastuzumab has completely changed the history of HER2-positive disease, and we can see from the combined meta-analysis of randomized trials that both in the metastatic setting and the adjuvant setting, the use of trastuzumab has substantially improved the prognosis. Here is the metastatic disease setting. You see that the use of trastuzumab has reduced the risk of progressive disease by 44% and the risk of dying by 21%. And the same, and of course, these results have been achieved also by prolonging anti-HER2 treatment beyond progression. And also for early breast cancer, the adjuvant use of trastuzumab is allowed to reduce the risk of relapse by 40% and the risk of dying by 34%. And of course, up to now, the standard adjuvant treatment is 1 year of trastuzumab added to chemotherapy. So this is certainly a major achievement, but there are still many new drugs coming or already available, and there are many clinical questions which are relevant in trying to optimize the treatment for our patients. So in advanced breast cancer, HER2-positive disease, for instance, there are at least two important questions to be. The first one is, how long is it worth to target HER2? And the second important question is, there are some patients with triple-positive disease, HER2-positive, hormone receptor-positive disease, where it might be reasonable to postpone the use of chemotherapy and to start with endocrine therapy. So let's go to the first question, which is how long is it worth to treat with anti-HER2 agents? We have now five phase three randomized clinical trials. Some of them are also relatively large. And all these trials very consistently show that giving another anti-HER2 agents after failing first-line chemo plus trastuzumab is beneficial for the patient. You see that in some of these trials, patients have received multiple lines of chemotherapy for metastatic disease and even multiple lines of anti-HER2 therapies for metastatic disease, in particular a trial from Williams comparing TDM1 to the treatment of physician's choice. All the patients had received at least one line of trastuzumab and one line of lapatinib. And you see very, very consistently all the trials, same message, targeting HER2 is beneficial for the patients. And it is even more impressive, this data, if we try to compare, to summarize on one slide what we have got in the last 15 years in the management of HER2-positive metastatic disease. You see the first line setting, the first pivotal trial from Dennis Lemon comparing chemotherapy to chemotherapy plus Herceptin, a significant improvement in survival with Herceptin. But nowadays, the Cleopatra trial comparing trastuzumab taxane and docetaxel versus trastuzumab pertuzumab and docetaxel, an unprecedented improvement in overall survival. And what is also striking is that if you see the median survival of the patients treated with docetaxel and trastuzumab is 40.8 months, significantly longer than the median survival of the patients treated with taxane plus trastuzumab in the pivotal Denisov-Lemos trial. And this is, of course, a consequence of the efficacy of subsequent therapies after first line. And the same you see in second and in third line. Now we can, in second line, for instance, see that with TDM1, you can have a median survival in second line after trastuzumab failure, which is much longer than the median survival observed with a pivotal first-line trial by Dennis Lemon. So certainly we can conclude that patients benefit from multiple lines of anti-tumor therapies? Second question, may upfront chemotherapy be spared to some patients? Of course, we cannot ignore the data from the Cleopatra trial. This is an unprecedented improvement in overall survival by adding pertuzumab to trastuzumab and the taxane, almost 16-month improvement in median survival. This is really an unprecedented improvement. But we cannot also not ignore that there are three randomized trials showing that in case of co-expression of HER2 and hormone receptor, the addition of an anti-HER2 agent to endocrine therapy, either trastuzumab or lapatinib, significantly improves the efficacy in terms of response rate and median progression-free survival over endocrine therapy alone. And this is a patient story from our own institution, just to show that you can really get very good results if you are able to select the right patient. This is a patient who was diagnosed in July 2000 with a PT1C node positive, estrogen receptor positive, HER2 positive tumor. At that time, trastuzumab was not approved in the adjuvant setting, so that patient received the adjuvant chemotherapy of anthracycline and taxane plus 5 years of tamoxifen. 9 years later, in June 2009, she had a relapse in a chest wall, which was not resectable. A biopsy was taken, and again, the same kind of biological characteristics were shown, ER positive, HER2 positive, and she started on letrozole, endocrine therapy, plus trastuzumab, and she went in a complete response, which lasted for 3 years, with letrozole and trastuzumab. In June 2012, she developed liver and bone disease, and she started, of course, chemotherapy and trastuzumab, and she received several lines of chemotherapy and anti-HER2 agents with lapatinib and T-DM1, and finally, unfortunately, she died on September 2014. But the key message from this patient story is that these patients survived from the first relapse for 63 months, and for the first 3 years, she survived and she had a disease control without getting any chemotherapy. So certainly, there are very carefully, and here the clinical judgment is extremely important, selected patients with triple positive disease, which means HER2 positive, hormone receptor positive, who can benefit from upfront endocrine therapy plus an anti-HER2 agent, and trying to postpone the start of chemotherapy. In early breast cancer disease, there are more treatments, there are more effective treatments than trastuzumab alone, and for which patients? Certainly there are more effective treatments, and the second question is there are patients for which treatment burden can be reduced. Certainly there are more effective treatments. Here are the data from the primary neoadjuvant trials with dual anti-HER2 blocks combining chemotherapy plus trastuzumab and lapatinib or trastuzumab and pertuzumab. And again, very consistently with some differences across the trial, but very consistently the message is dual block of HER2 is better in terms of pathological complete remission than single anti-HER2 treatment. So we do have better therapies. And on the basis of some of this data, FDA has last year decided to approve pertuzumab in addition to chemotherapy and trastuzumab for the neoadjuvant treatment of HER2-positive early breast cancer. So it has been a great disappointment for many of us to see the data from the ALTO adjuvant trial, where the dual blockade of HER2 with trastuzumab combined with lapatinib after chemotherapy, of course, didn't significantly improve the disease-free survival. So what went wrong between the neoadjuvant and the adjuvant setting? Certainly, the ALTO trial is a negative trial. Primary endpoint, which was disease-free survival, was not met. Certainly, there are some possible explanation to explain why this suboptimal result was achieved, and for instance, the tolerability to lapatinib is one possible explanation. A significant minority of the patients were not able to receive enough lapatinib because of toxicity. But trying to go more in depth to explain why the neo-alto results in the neoadjuvant setting did translate into improved outcome in the adjuvant setting, the alto trial, we have to explore, I think, the role of the outcome, pathological complete response versus disease-free, and also the role of the patient selection. In the neo-alto trial, which I remind you was very similar to ALTO, again comparing chemo plus trastuzumab versus chemo plus lapatinib versus chemo plus the combination of trastuzumab and lapatinib, again showed that the dual HER2 block was better in terms of pathological complete response, and also showed that the patients who achieved, as expected, a pathological complete response had a significantly better outcome than those who didn't achieve a pathological complete response. And you see also that comparing the three arms, there is a trend which is not significant because the study was not powered to see a significant difference, but there was a trend showing that the outcome of the patients receiving chemo plus trastuzumab plus lapatinib are doing slightly better than those receiving chemo plus single anti-HER2 block. So neo-alto clearly was in line with the expectation of dual block being better than single block. So why the better PCR-OS didn't translate so far, do not translate so far into a better outcome? Certainly, we still have preliminary data. We need more survival data, more trials, more prolonged follow-up from neoadjuvant trials. But certainly we have to acknowledge that not all the patients who achieve a pathological complete response will remain disease-free forever, and not all the patients who do not achieve a pathological complete response will eventually relapse. We probably need much larger differences in pathological complete remission ways to see a real difference in outcome, in disease-free. And finally, and to me this is probably the most important point, there are main differences even in HER2-positive disease according to the hormonal receptor status. Probably the PCR-OS is a very good predictor of outcome in case of HER2-positive hormone receptor-negative disease. It might be a less good predictor of outcome in case of HER2-positive hormone receptor-positive disease, because for these patients, even if they do not achieve a pathological complete response, of course, we have a very effective treatment after neoadjuvant treatment, which is endocrine therapy. So many of these patients, even if they do not achieve a PCR, can be saved and survive without disease because of endocrine therapy. And the second point is a different patient population. If you want to compare the patient population from neo-alto to alto, apart from the numbers, of course, you see that in the neo-alto, the patients were much younger, they had much larger tumors, and also we had more hormone receptor negative disease. And that these patients were different is clearly shown also from the outcome. If you look to the arm chemo plus trastuzumab, you see that the 3-year event-free survival for the neo-alto patients is 76%. In the alto arm, same treatment, alto adjuvant setting, the 4-year disease-free survival was 86%, so clearly different patient population. So probably adjuvant trial with new, more effective therapies should exclude patients with low intermediate risk and include also selected subgroups of patients. And can we select or try to select who are the patients who might benefit more from dual anti-HER2 block? We have some very preliminary, of course, but some potentially interesting data coming out. These are data from our own group and also other groups showing that, for instance, the PIK3 CA mutational status can predict the benefit of dual anti-HER2 blocks. In all these neoadjuvant trials, the dual anti-HER2 blocks was able to significantly increase the pathological remission rate only in those patients with a PIK3CA wild-type tumors, while in case of mutated PIK3CA tumors, there was no benefit from adding another anti-HER2 agents to chemo plus trastuzumab. And one other potential parameter is the grade of tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes. Last question is, for which patients treatment burden can be reduced? This is also a very important question. Let's go again to the data from Neoalto versus Alto. 4-year disease-free survival with chemo plus trastuzumab alone in Alto trial is 86%. It's quite difficult to improve significantly further over these numbers. The Alto trial clearly demonstrate that the vast majority of HER2-positive early breast cancer patients nowadays are already cured with chemotherapy and 1 year of trastuzumab. They do not need any other additional treatment. So, for many of these patients, the question is not to develop more effective therapies, but probably for many of patients, can we reduce the burden of treatment? And there are some data from phase two trials which are of great interest in this setting. These are two recent publications, one from the group of Eric Weiner, another one from Stephen Jones, where patients considered at low risk in spite of having HER2-positive disease because of a small T size and, in most of the cases, node negativity, all node negative in the Eric Weiner trial, 79% not negative in the trial from Jones, received reduced chemotherapy, only 12 weeks of weekly paclitaxel in the APT trial, only 4 courses of docetaxel cyclophosphamide in the Stephen Jones trial, and in spite of this reduced burden of chemotherapy, they had a very good outcome, 98% disease-free at 3 years in the APT trial, 97.8% disease-free at 2 years in the Jones trial. But unfortunately, in spite of reduced burden of chemotherapy, these patients still had some cardiac dysfunctions, which are not so different from those observed in the patients treated in adjuvant trial of trastuzumab. 3.7% cardiac events in APT, 6% in the other trial. Of course, only a few of these were congestive heart failures. And the only way to reduce the incidence of cardiac events, in fact, seems to be to reduce the duration of anti-HER2 treatment. Here are the comparisons between 3 different trials with 3 different duration of anti-HER2 treatment. You see that with no trastuzumab, the incidence of cardiac events is 1.3%. With 1 year trastuzumab is 4%. In the FAIR trial, 6 month trastuzumab, 1.9% cardiac events. 1 year trastuzumab, 5.7% cardiac events. In the HER trial, no trastuzumab, 1% cardiac events. 1 year trastuzumab, 5.2%. 2 years, 9.4. So all the trials, same clear message. The duration of anti-HER2 treatment is important to determine the extent of cardiac events. So I think it's important to wait from the data from trials exploring shorter duration of trastuzumab treatment to see if we can reduce the burden of the treatment also in terms of cardiac events. So, can treatment burden be reduced? Certainly, because more than 80% of real-world patients are cured with present therapy. They do not need any additional treatment. And treatment burden can be reduced without jeopardizing outcome in this patient population. The last point is, can we develop more sophisticated way to personalize the treatment with new drugs for our patients, especially taking into account the subgroup of the patients with co-expression of HER2 and hormone receptors, which are 60% of HER2-positive disease. And this is a trial we're running presently in our institution in Padua, where post-menopausal HER2-positive, hormone receptor-positive patients are treated with, we take a biopsy, of course, we evaluate Ki-67 baseline. The patients receive 2 weeks of letrozole, after 2 weeks, we take another biopsy and we evaluate the inhibition of Ki67. If there is a very good molecular response, which means a decrease in Ki67, the patient continues on letrozole plus trastuzumab plus pertuzumab, no chemotherapy at all. If there is no significant decrease in Ki67, the patient stops letrozole and starts taxane chemo plus pertuzumab and trastuzumab. And the primary endpoint of the trial is the pathological perturbation weight in the two arms, of course. So this is my final slide. Certainly the introduction of trastuzumab in 1998 for the treatment of HER2-positive metastatic disease has been a major breakthrough. But since then, we have many other options, many other regimens, many other anti-HER2 drugs. It's up to us as clinicians to make the right selection to provide excellence to the individual patients. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Conti, for this excellent presentation. And I'd like to ask you to postpone the questions till the end of the session, if you don't mind.
It's okay.
Okay. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Professor